Please welcome the Secretary General of the United Nations, Anto nio Guterres.
As you can imagine, is a problem of implementation. It's very good to have a Paris Agreement in climate change. But first of all, the Paris Agreement is not enough. Even if the Paris commitments will be met, the temperatures in the world will be rising more than 3 degrees in the end of the century, and that would be catastrophic. And on the other hand, it is also clear that not all countries are abiding by the commitments made in Paris, which means we need to have an enhanced ambition in relation to climate change. And the same applies to fighting for a fair globalization. We need to be able to combine efforts of governments, of companies, of the business sector, of financial markets, of the civil society, in order to make sure that we are able to eradicate poverty, to bring education and health for all, to clean the oceans, and to do a number of other things that are essential for the life in our planet to be sustainable and to be inclusive. And again, this is difficult. The problem is implementation. But the good news is that science is on our side. Look at climate action. Today it's clear that thanks to new technologies, thanks to green technologies, the green economy is the economy of the future. The green business is the good business, and you can at the same time make money and do good. And the same applies. Combination of new technologies that represent what we call today the fourth industrial revolution in relation to information and communication technologies, and then the artificial intelligence that has been so many times mentioned tonight, but also biotechnologies, nanotechnologies, and other forms of innovation that will allow us to create the conditions to be able to have indeed a growth and a development that benefits everybody, and to create the conditions to combine simultaneously what was the spectacular development we witnessed in the last decade, but with tackling the climate and being able to make sure that the benefits of development are distributed by all. So science is on our side. And I am a true believer that this fourth industrial revolution can be the answer to the main questions that we are putting ourselves today, facing the enormous difficulties that we are still facing in the different aspects of social inequality, in the different aspects of the deterioration of the environment, and in the different other threats to our collective life. But as in relation to the past, we need to be able now to look into the near future with a strategic vision and combining the action of governments, with the private sector, with researchers, academia, the civil society, in order to be able to make sure that this fourth industrial revolution is indeed, in all its aspects, a force for good. Now, it is clear that this fourth industrial revolution will have a dramatic impact in our societies, in our way of life, but also in labor markets. And it's very important to anticipate the potential negative impacts of this technological evolution. Just to give an example, in the country where I live today, in the US, the profession that has more people working in it is driving. Now, very probably, in a few years' time, we will not need drivers for cars, drivers for trucks, and drivers for the majority of the equipment we have to handle. So, we risk to have massive unemployment, both in the developed and the developing world, with the development of some of the new technologies that we are facing. The answer is not, of course, to stop that development. The answer is to be able to adapt the way we work in our societies in order to be able to anticipate this trend instead of responding to it when it comes and doing it too late, as it sometimes has happened in the past. And that means a revolution and the massive investment in education and training. And the education we need for the future is different from the education we are used to discuss. It's not how to learn to do things, but how to learn how to learn. Because the things we do will not be done tomorrow. And the way we think our educational systems need to be essentially rethought. Safety nets, social safety nets need also to change. And even the way we look at work and leisure, the way we divide our times, the way we divide our lives, will have to change quite dramatically. And so it is absolutely essential that governments, the civil society, the business sector, the academia, work together, discuss together, raise these issues that have been ignored in the public debate, because those are the issues that will allow us to be able to face the future and to avoid the mistakes of the past. And my appeal to those that are in this Web Summit, again, governments, businesses, academia, researchers, scientists, is to start seriously discussing the impacts of the fourth industrial revolution in the societies of tomorrow. And then, as it was said in several of the interventions we heard, science and technology are not value neutral. We can use genetic engineering to get rid of diseases, and that is fantastic, but we can use genetic engineering to produce monsters, and that is terrible. We can use the cyberspace to facilitate our lives in everyday work that we do and in all other aspects of the way we live in the community. But we can also use the cyberspace to facilitate the recruitment of terrorists for terrorist organizations. Now, when we are aware of this fact, I think it's important to think how we can make sure that innovation is a force for good. And there are, I think, two things we need to avoid. First is the stupid reaction to say, let's stop innovation. And it is stupid because it is impossible. And because it will not allow to take benefit of all the positive aspects of innovation. So those that say, this is too dangerous, too complicated, it's better to stop it, I think that they have no point. And second thing, to avoid the naive approach to think that traditional forms of regulation, like the ones we have today for energy or for the financial system or for the insurance system, can solve the problem. The truth is that those forms of regulation that are usually managed by governments or by intergovernmental organizations take time, they are complex, they are one-sided, and obviously they are not able to respond to the fast-changing world we are now facing with these new technologies and new forms of innovation. Which means that the only way to be able to establish mechanisms of regulation for the future will have to be different. We'll have to combine all stakeholders. We'll have to bring together governments, companies like the ones we heard today, scientists like the ones who, like Stephen Hawking that spoke to us, but also the civil society, the academia, and again, establish platforms of discussion how to do norm-setting, how to establish regulatory frameworks that are flexible, that allow to combine the freedom of innovation that is absolutely essential for the future of humankind, but to combine it with the protection of human rights that is absolutely essential also to preserve the social cohesion of our societies. Governments cannot do it alone. Intergovernmental organizations like the UN cannot do it alone. This needs to be done by all actors, coming and discussing it together, and this is why the Web Summit is so important here today. And to do it properly, we need to make sure that we combine our energies, to make sure that we are able to put all our experiences together, and that we use opportunities like these to seriously discuss the problems that we face, and at the same time to maximize the potential of the enormous advantages that the innovations we are discussing can provide to our world. I do believe that this Web Summit is an opportunity for us to come together, and coming together to make sure that the power of science, the power of technology, and the power of innovation are a power for good, to make a better world and for the benefit of us all. Thank you very much.